Hey guys, give me one moment. I'm having an issue with my stream. Yes, this happened earlier. Remember, it wasn't capturing anything. I don't know why. No, there's nothing there. Let me try and close it. I don't know why it's not capturing anything. I know you can see Discord, that's okay. There's nothing up there. It's not capturing what it's supposed to be capturing. And actually, it says it's capturing Steam right now, but it's not. What are you talking about? Yeah, I know. I'm not worried about it, guys. See, it's not even capturing my ASMR virtual cottage. I don't know, guys. Give me a minute. Yeah, I am. No, Rose, that's a different screen. It's not capturing Steam or anything else for that matter. And guys, I don't know what to do. Yeah, I do. Thank you. Hey guys, sorry, I don't know what happened. It wouldn't capture the screen. Alright. Oh, that would have been fun. I'm sorry, guys. I don't know what the heck happened. There we go. Actually, Nerd didn't do anything. It just decided to start working on its own. So we're not gonna touch anything. I'm not touching anything, guys, at all, period, ever again. It did this to me earlier, too, so. Alright, guys, so how is everyone? Guess what you found? A CD. I don't know. I'm okay, but my lip hurts. There's a movie on Amazon Prime called Llamageddon. Yes, please. Thank you for the follow, Red Flashpool. And welcome. I hope you enjoy. Self-conscious, my screen's gonna show. Guys, let me know if you see the personal DMs. Alright. So I'm gonna start with a poem that was sent in by Nerd, and it is called Do Not Go Gentle Into That Good Night by Dylan Thomas. Hopefully, fingers crossed. Alright. Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Men, wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight and learned too late, they grieved it's on its way. Do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying light. And you, my father, there on this sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears. I pray, do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Thank you, Nerd, for sending that in. No problem. Nobody else. We all thought it was. Panda said, bruh. And I was like, ooh, that's a must watch. I'll watch the Llamageddon. Okay, guys. So Chase sent me this one. It's called The Five Boons of Life by Mark Twain. A boon is something that is considered beneficial or helpful. Chapter 1. In the morning of life came a good fairy with her basket and said, here are gifts. Take one, leave the others, and be wary, choose wisely, oh choose wisely, for only one of them is valuable. The gifts were five: fame, love, riches, pleasure, and death. The youth said eagerly, there is no need to consider, and he chose pleasure. He went out into the world and sought out the pleasures that youth delights in. But each in its turn was short-lived and disappointing, vain and empty, and each departing mocked him. Sorry, guys. In the end, he said, these years I have wasted. If I could but choose again, I would choose wisely. Chapter 2. The fairy appeared and said, four of the gifts remain. Choose once more, and oh, remember, time is flying, and only one of them is precious. The man considered long, then chose love, and did not mark the tears that rose in the fairy's eyes. After many, many years, the man sat by a coffin in an empty home, and he communed with himself, saying, one by one they have gone away and left me, and now she lies here, the dearest and the last. Desolation after desolation has swept over me. For each hour of happiness, the treacherous traitor, love, has sold me, I have paid 1,000 hours of grief. Out of my heart of hearts, I curse him. Chapter 3. Choose again. It was the fairy speaking. The years have taught you wisdom. Surely it must be so. Three gifts remain. Only one of them has any worth. Remember it and choose warily. The man reflected long, then chose vain. And the fairy, sighing, went her way. Years went by, and she came again, and stood behind the man where he sat solitary in the fading day, thinking. And she knew his thought. My name filled the world, and its praises were on every tongue. And it seemed well for me to have for a little while. How a little while it was. Then came envy, then detraction, then calumny. Then hate, then persecution, then derision, which is the beginning of the end, and last of all came pity, which is the funeral of fame. Oh, the bitterness and misery of renown, target for the mud in its prime, for contempt and compassion in its decay. Chapter 4. Choose yet again, it was the fairy's voice. Two gifts remain, and I do not despair. In the beginning, there was but one that was precious, and it's still here. Wealth, which is power, how blind I was, said the man. Now at last, life will be worth the living. I will spend it, squander, dazzle. These mockers and despisers will crawl into the dirt before me, and I will feed my hunger heart with their envy. I will have all luxuries, all joys, all enchantments of the spirit, all contentments of the body that the man holds dear. I will buy, deference, respect, esteem, worship, every pinch, beck, grace of life, the market of a trivial world can furnish forth. I have lost much time and chosen bad heretofore, but let that pass. I was ignorant then and could but take the best. What seems so? Hello, ghost. 3 short years went by, and a day came when the man sat shivering in a mean garret. And he was a gaunt and wan and hollow-eyed and clothes in rags, and he was gnawing a dry crust and mumbling, curse all the world's gifts for mockeries and gilded lies and miscalled every one. They are not gifts but merely lendings, pleasure, love, fame, riches. They are but temporary disguises for lasting realities. pain, grief, shame, poverty. The fairy said, "Is true. In all her store there was but one gift which was precious, only one that was not valueless. How poor and cheap and mean I know those others now to be, compared with that inestimable one, that dear and sweet and kindly one, that steeps in dreamless and enduring sleep the pains that persecute the body, and the shames and griefs that eat the mind and heart. Bring it, I am weary, I would rest." Chapter 5. The fairy came, bringing again four of the gifts, but death was wanting. She said, "I gave it to a mother's pet, a little child. It was ignorant, but trusted me, asking me to choose for it. You did not ask me to choose. Oh, miserable me, what is left for me? What not even you have deserved, the wanton insult of old age." The end. Capper. Okay. Give me 1 second, you guys. Okay guys, I have Tilly, and she is ready, and she is so chunky, because she's been eating a lot of food. Let me turn down the rain for you guys. She is. She's such a beautiful little baby. Thank you for the biddies, Rose. Let's go, some kitty lovin's. Don't you guys worry, I'm working on getting you some bunny and kitty emotes. We're gonna make some Tilly and Cloud emotes for you guys. Per Cloud Crunch, yes. Okay, guys. Oh, she's meowing. I don't know if you can hear her. Wrong enter key. Okay, guys. This one is Oh Captain, My Captain by Walt Whitman. Oh Captain, My Captain, our fearful trip is done. The ship has weathered every rack. The prize we sought is won. The port is near, the bells I hear, the people all exulting, while follow eyes the steady keel, the vessel grim and daring. But oh heart, 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 oh the bleeding drops of red, where on the deck my captain lies, fallen cold and dead. Oh captain, my captain, rise up and hear the bells. Rise up for you, the flag is flung for you. The bolt bugle drills for the bouquets and ribboned wreath for you. The shores are crowding for you. They call the swaying mass, their eager faces turning. Here, captain, dear father, this arm beneath your head. It is some dream that on the deck you've fallen cold and dead. My captain does not answer. His lips are pale and still. My father does not feel my arm. He has no pulse nor will. The ship is anchored safe and sound. Its voyage closed and done. From fearful trip to vector ship, comes in with object one. Exult, O shores, and ring, O bells. But I, with mournful tread, walk the deck. My captain lies, fallen cold and dead. Okay, guys, this one is A Dream Within a Dream by Edgar Allan Poe. Take this kiss upon the brow, and in parting from you know. Now, this much let me avow, you are not wrong who deem that my days have been a dream. Yet if hope has flown away, in a night or in a day, in a vision or in none, is it therefore the less gone? All that we see or seem, but is it a dream within a dream? I stand amid the roar of a surf-tormented shore, and I hold within my hand grains of the golden sand. How few, yet how they creep through my fingers to the deep. While I weep, O God, can I not grasp them with the tighter clasp? O God, can I not save one of the pitiless wave? It is all that we see or seem but a dream within a dream. Okay. And one of the stories for tonight is called Hans the Hedgehog by the Brothers Grimm. There was once a countryman who had money and land in plenty, but how rich soever he was, one thing was still wanting in his happiness. He has no children. Often when he went into the town with the other peasants, they mocked him and asked why he had no children. At last he became angry. And when he got home, he said, I will have a child, even if it be a hedgehog. Then his wife had a child that was a hedgehog, and in the upper part of his body, and a boy in the lower. And when she saw the child, she was terrified and said, "See, there thou hast brought us ill luck on us." Then the man said, "What can be done now? The boy must be Christian, and we shall not be able to get a godfather for him." The woman said, "And we cannot call him anything else but Hans the Hedgehog." When he was christened, the parson said, "He cannot go into any ordinary bed because of his spikes." So a little straw was put behind the stove, and Hans the Hedgehog was laid on it. His mother could not suckle him, for he would have pricked her with his quills. So he lay there behind the stove for 8 years, and his father was tired of him and thought, "If he would but die." He did not die, however, but remained lying there. Now it happened that there was a fair in town, and the peasant was about to go to it, and asked his wife what he should bring back with him for her. "A little meat and a couple of white rolls, which are wanted for the house," she said. Then he asked the servant, and she wanted a pair of slippers and some stockings with clocks. At last he also said, "And what wilt thou have, Hans, my hedgehog?" "Dear father," he said, "do bring me bagpipes." When therefore the father came home again, he gave his wife what he had bought for her, meat and white rolls, and then he gave the maid the slippers and the stockings with the clocks. And lastly, he went behind the stove and gave Hans the hedgehog the bagpipes. And when Hans the hedgehog had the bagpipes, he said, "Dear father, do go to the forge and get cockshy, and then I will ride away and never come back again." On this, the father was delighted to think that he was going to get rid of him, and had the cockshod for him. And when it was done, Hans the hedgehog got on it and rode away, but took swine and asses with him, and which he intended to keep in the forest. When they got there, he made the cock fly high into a tree with him, and there he sat for many a long year and watched his asses and swine until the herd was quite large, and his father knew nothing about him. While he was sitting in the tree, however, he played his bagpipes and made music, which was very beautiful. Once a king came traveling by who had lost his way and heard the music. He was astonished at it, and he sent his servant forth to look for the round and see him whence this music came. He spied about, but saw nothing but a little animal sitting aloft on a tree, which looked like a cock with a hedgehog on it, which made this music. Then the king told the servant he was to ask why he sat there, and if he knew the road which led to his kingdom. So Hans the hedgehog descended from the tree, and said he would show the way if the king would write a bond and promise him whatever he first met in the royal courtyard as soon as he arrived at home. Then the king thought, "I can easily do that. Hans the hedgehog understands nothing, and I can write like what I like." So the king took a pen and ink and wrote something, and when he had done it, Hans the hedgehog showed him the way, and he got safely home. But his daughter, when she saw him from afar, was so overjoyed that she ran to meet him and kissed him. Then he remembered Hans the hedgehog and told her what happened, and that he had been forced to promise whatsoever first met him when he got home to a very strange animal which sat on a cock as if it were a horse, and made beautiful music. But instead of writing that he should have what he wanted, he had written that he should not have it. Thereupon the princess was glad, and said he had done well, for she never would have gone away with the hedgehog. Hans the hedgehog, however, looked after his asses and pigs, and was merry, and sat on a tree and played his bagpipes. Now it came to pass that another king came journeying by with his attendants and runners, and he also had lost his way, and did not know how to get home again because the forest was so large. He likewise heard the beautiful music from a distance, and asked his runner what he could be, and told him to go see Thinking Nerd. Then the runner went under the tree and saw the cock sitting at top of it, and Hans the hedgehog on the cock. Thank you, guys. The runner asked him what he was about up there. "I am keeping my asses and my pigs, but what is your desire?" The messenger said that he had lost their way and could not get back into their own kingdom, and asked if he would not show them the way. Then Hans the Hedgehog got down the tree with the cock and told the aged king that he would show him the way. Whatsoever first met him in front of his royal palace. The king said yes and made the promise that he should have. That done, Hans rode on before him on the cock and pointed out the way. Sorry, guys. I think I scrolled up a little bit and lost my spot. Okay, the king reached his kingdom again in safety. When he got to the courtyard, there were great rejoicings. Now he had an only daughter who was very beautiful. She ran to meet him, threw her arms around his neck, and was delighted to have her old father back again. She asked him where in the world he had been so long. So he told her now how he had lost his way and had not nearly come back at all, but that he was traveling through a great forest, a creature, half hedgehog, half man, who was sitting astride a cock in a high tree and making music, had shown him the way and helped him to get out, but that in return he had promised him whatsoever he first met him in the courtyard, and how that she was herself, which made him unhappy now, but on this promised that for love of her father she would willingly go with Hans if he came. Hans the Hedgehog, however, took care of his pigs, and the pigs multiplied until they became so many in number that the whole forest was filled with them. Then Hans the Hedgehog resolved not to live in the forest any longer, and sent word to his father to have every sty in the village empty, for he was coming with such great herd that all might kill who wished to do so. When his father heard that, he was troubled, for he thought Hans the Hedgehog had died long ago. Hans the Hedgehog, however, seated himself on the cock and drove the pigs before him into the village, and ordered the slaughter to begin. Ha! But there was a killing and chopping that might have been heard 2 miles off. After this, Hans the Hedgehog said, "Father, let me have the cock shot once more at the forge, and then I will ride away and never come back as long as I live." Then the father had the cock shot once more, and he was pleased that Hans the Hedgehog would never return again. He rode away to the first kingdom. There the king had commanded that whosoever come unmounted on a cock and had bagpipes with him shall be shot down, cut down, or stabbed by everyone so that he might not enter the palace. When therefore Hans the Hedgehog came riding thither, they all pressed forward against him with their pikes. But he spurred the cock and flew up over the gate in front of the king's window and lighted there, and Hans cried that the king must give him what they had promised, or he would take both his life and his daughter's. Then the king began to speak his daughter fair and to beg her to go away with Hans in order to save her own life and her father's. So she dressed herself in white, and her father gave her a carriage with 6 white horses and a magnificent attendant, together with gold and possessions. She seated herself in the carriage and placed Hans the Hedgehog beside her with the cock and the bagpipes, and then they took leave and drove away. And the king thought he should never see her again. He was, however, deceived in his expectation, for when they were at a short distance from the town, Hans took her pretty clothes off and pierced her with his hedgehog skin until she bled all over. That is the reward of your falseness, said he. Go on your way, I will not have you. And on that, he chased her home again, and she was disgraced for the rest of her life. Hans the Hedgehog, however, rode on further with his bagpipes to the dominions of the second king, to whom he had shown the way. This one, however, had arranged that if anyone resembling Hans should come, they were to present arms, give him safe conduct, cry long life to him, and lead him to the royal palace. okay, Rose. It's okay. But when the king's daughter saw him, she was terrified, for he looked quite too strange. She remembered, however, that she could not change her mind, for she had given her promise to her father. So Hans the Hedgehog was welcomed by her and married to her, and had to go with her to the royal table. And she seated herself by his side, and they ate and drank. When the evening came, they wanted to go to sleep. She was afraid of his quills, but told her not to fear, for no harm would befall her. And he told the old king that he was to appoint 4 men to watch by the door of the chamber and light a great fire. And when he entered the room and was about to get into bed, he would creep out of the hedgehog's skin and leave it lying there by the bedside. And that men were to run nimbly to it, throw it in the fire, and stay by it until it was consumed. Panda. When the clock struck 11, he went into the chamber, stripped off the hedgehog's skin, and left it lying by the bed. Then came the men and fetched it swiftly and threw it into the fire. And when the fire had consumed it, he was delivered and lay there in bed in human form. But he was coal black as if he had been burnt. The king sent for a physician who washed him with precious salves and anointed him, and he became white, and he was a handsome young man. When the king's daughter saw that, she was glad. And the next morning they arose joyfully, ate a drink and drank, and then the marriage was properly solemnized, and Hans the Hedgehog received the kingdom from the aged king. When several years had passed, he went with his wife to his father and said that he was his son. The father, however, declared he had no son. He had never had but one, and he had been born like a hedgehog with spikes and had gone forth into the world. Then Hans made himself known, and the old father rejoiced and went limp to his kingdom. My tale is done, and away it is run to little August's house. See, it wasn't all bad. You're back. You had to talk. Oh, spoiler alert. I'm sorry to hear that. I'm gonna read you guys a couple cute little quotes here. If you guys have anything you'd like me to read, feel free to send it in. Love is composed of a single soul inhabiting 2 bodies, Aristotle. If I had a star for every time you brighten my day, I will be holding the galaxy in my hands. Author unknown. A friend is someone who knows all about you and still loves you. Albert Hubbard. There is only one happiness in this life, to love and to be loved. George Sand. Sanity and happiness are an impossible combination. Mark Twain. gonna do something a little bit different. I'm going to find poems for you guys, but I want you to think of a word that you might find in a poem, or a word that comes to mind, and put it in the chat and I'll find you a poem. What word comes to mind? Okay. All right. Trust a poem written by Big Verge. So who do you trust? Do you trust you to make smart moves and pick wisely in who you choose to be wifey? Or ladies, do you trust that your baby will not become crazy when their father is lazy and always was shady? And I don't mean slim, more like that gimp. Yep, chained to sin. Were you thinking these things when you slept with him? Do you trust your decisions? Take a minute and position an honest disposition before you give an answer that bombs just like, we're going to censor that word for your safety. That's right, I used his name. Do you trust the things he says? I could have used censored something else. I'm so sorry. Whew. I trust, but I'm not willing to recognize that sinning is how cool folks be living. Cause sinners prove with quickness that trusting them can cause problems. When their defense trusts in nonsense, I trust one day that they will pay for threats they make and lives that they will take, because their way is to take the whole cake. Depression? Okay. So there were only two poems, and I read the shorter of the two, and, yeah. Somebody was a very angry person when they wrote that poem. Just throwing that out there. Okay. This one is called Kissed by Depression. Punches for you. I feel numb when we're arguing. Mad because you can't sleep with me. But how can I hand any more of myself over? All I see in you are your choices, and you chose her. All of this time, I've taken the punches for you. But how long can my body stand being black and blue? I have another one I'm gonna read that's a depression poem, and I just kind of skimmed through it, and I think it's a good one. Feel free to drop more words down below in the chat. One night, depression knocks on my door, so I let it in without knowing its identity. I let it in because I think it needs my help. I let it in, and then it reveals its personality, depression. Depression is an earthquake. I don't know when it will come, but when it appears, it creates havoc. I don't know where it comes from. Depression is a rain of tears, and when time passes by, it becomes storm and my great fear. Depression is sad and tragic movie that makes my tears fall freely and rapidly. Yes, it is a sad movie that makes me cry at night, and I don't know why I'm doing so, and I can't understand this plight. Depression is the brother of anxiety, who can just knock me down easily. Depression is a friend I want my mother to know, but she says, let your stupidity go. Depression is the handcuffs locked on my wrist that I don't even know it still exists. Depression It's the coffee that stops me to sleep at night. Depression is the onion that can easily make me cry. Depression is the voice ringing in my head. Depression is the monster under my bed. Depression. Depression is a car in the parking lot, and I'm the parking lot I don't want to be at. Depression is the ghost that haunts a house, although I'm the house I don't want to live at. Depression is a star that always stays in the sky, and I'm the sky I don't want to look at. I'm sorry, Panda. Depression is a star that always stays in the sky, and I'm the sky I don't want to look at. Depression is a silly child who asks me, "Are you tired of living?" But I just answer with, "I'm tired of dying," because depression kills me every day. Depression makes me feel I'm already dead. It is a bullet that in my heart stays forever. It is a vicious, painful word forever said. Depression is not a treasure from a chest. Depression is not a kind guest. So when depression knocks on your door, don't open it if you don't want to have a deadly tour. Because when depression knocks on your door, if it wants to make you feel lonely until you don't know why you're lonely anymore. Alright, joy. Complete reverse. You're welcome. I felt like that one was a good one. Someone clip that so I can hear the whole thing. Nerd. Depression probably. I came in like a wrecking ball. I'm not doing a Miley Cyrus voice though. Yep. Thank you. Okay. My experience and exploration of joy. Joy is walking in the softest morning mist, looking for the sun. Joy is seeing love in the eyes for the one you care for. Joy is in watching the giggling child. Joy is the knowledge gained by opening your mind. Joy is in chatting with the wind. Joy is in wearing an old sweater which once belonged to him. Joy is in finding happiness when everything's not right. Joy in the stars shining so bright. Joy is in forgetting stress. Joy is coming out of a mess. Joy is in living. Joy is in dying. Joy is in the peaks of mighty mountains, in the echoes of rain. Joy is running in all my veins. Joy is all this and much more. Joy is the thing to explore. If I ever had words to describe joy, I have always hoped it would turn out to be me. That was wonderful. Infatuation. Sorry guys, this site is slow. It loads really slow because there's so many poems on here. Yeah, it was a nice one. Last couple have been pretty spot on. Pulled up and my site crashed. Hold on. Thank you for the biddies, ghost. Infatuation by Vanessa Mentor. Thank you, Ghost. I appreciate it. Infatuation. It started out simple, like something new. I knew from the beginning there was just something about you. I never knew there would be a better tomorrow, but you've come into my life and taken away all my sorrow. My days of sadness are a thing of the past because I have found true love at last. The sight of your lovely face takes away from all my fears. You're the one I want to love throughout the years. Thinking of a time where you'll no longer be here is not acceptable to me. Because beside me is where I'll always want you to be. I wish I could just rewind time to how it was before. But however much she loves you now, I will always love you more. It does sound pretty, doesn't it? Did you have a word? Ghost. A word, yes, for a poem. Pick a word, whatever comes to mind, and write it down. And hit enter. Type it out, hit enter. I can do a few more. I know what Panda probably. Yep, I was gonna say I know what Panda probably wants. Okay, Panda. Here you go. This one's a cute, funny one. Pandas all love Sundays. It's the day they wash their bums, and when their bums are nice and clean, they insert their panda thumbs. Okay, Ghost, I will get you that trust poem. Okay, Trust by Ms. Moam. I like to believe in people. My trust is easily earned. But please don't take it for granted, as it's a bridge that quickly burned. I did not break again. Fine, guys. Thank you, Ghost. I'll read an actual one, okay? If you ever go to China, look out for black and white. I'll be climbing up a tree. I am a rare sight. I'm a little shy and love eating bamboo. Take care of my habitat and I sit here and chew. I need the trees to climb. I need bamboo to eat. My species is too precious to accept defeat. I am the symbol of peace. In China, I am renowned. I am loved by all the people and hope to stay around. Written by Resource Rose. Bamboo, yay. Thank you so much. I sure muted the lab. No. Who would do that? Oh my goodness, you guys. So I know that says 11 minutes to go on the timer, but we are at our 1 hour mark. Some sassy ASMR streamer, that's it. Not me. Anyway, thank you guys for joining me tonight. I'm sorry about the technical difficulties in the beginning. Rose's poem, Dog. Oh, she put dog? I missed it. I'm so sorry, Rose. I didn't see it. I think it's probably when I was laughing about the other one. One more, yes. I thought she was calling Panda a dog, my bad. Okay. He is your friend, your partner, your defender, your dog. You are his life, his love, his leader. He will be yours, faithful and true, to the last beat of his heart. You owe it to him to be worthy of such devotion. Unknown. I'll actually read you this one too, real quick. I Could Chew on This, by Francesco Marciolano. Wingman. I wag my tail, I tilt my head, I give a little wink, I flash my smile, I show my belly, I give a little lick, I do it all, from sit to speak, to attract women far and near, then you chime in with something about fan fiction, and I realize we're going to die alone. I thought that one was funny. Okay. He's not reformed anymore. Cooper jail he goes. Yeah, do it to a dying alone. Sarcasm, we know. Pick some chill pills. Sarcasm. Sarchase. Alright, guys. That is all for now. For now. For me. I hope you guys enjoyed it. And I will see you guys tomorrow. You are all loved, you are all worthy, and I appreciate every single one of you, and I hope you all have a good night. Thank you, Zedekus. Good night, guys.